This is 1997. And we grow. We mature. And throughout those years, some of the greatest minds among us has resolved that we have to cease calling ourselves by an adjective, black. A nation has to call itself by a noun, okay? And we have to get away from the shame or the fear of being called Africans. We are Africans. And we have to be proud of the fact that we are Africans. Sure, we got native blood. We got some of every blood in the world. But everything began in Africa, so why not? With an all easier doing things from a Eurocentric viewpoint, why not try the wheel? Afrocentric, where life really began, where everything really evolved from. So we are Africans, and we call ourselves New Africans to distinguish from the motherland. So this is the new term in identifying our nation, and Imari Obadeli of the Republic of New Africa, Chukwuma Mubo, and Dr. Mutulu were very instrumental in bringing this realization about and getting us to understand ourselves. Because just like we have to understand our enemy, we have to also understand ourselves. So that self-identification is very important. And it goes into our historical personality that's based on our Africanity. It's not based on any Europeanness other than this intrusion by slavery. And when you carry on the legacy of slave masters, you are doing our movement a great disservice. When you carry on the legacy of a dog who raped your grandmama, and you got this child, like little baby Shaggy back here, and you say you love your child, and you turn around and you give that child the name of this dog who raped your grandmama, I can't understand that. You're giving that child an evil spirit. That's what our ancestors taught us. The power of the Momo. The power of the word. So don't give those children those names of the Watani of the devil. Because you're cursing those children. And when they grow up, their first name may be Jamal, but their last name may be Rothschild or somebody who participated in that. That ain't gonna work. Because when they grow up, they're gonna have that divided conscience again, and they're gonna end up where I was talking to Brother G. In penitentiary, or dead. They got that divided conscience, that social schizophrenia that you see so prevalent among us because we are so scared to re-embrace our ancestry fully by changing both our names and giving that legacy to our children so they can carry it on, not the legacy of our slave masters. That causes a lot of disrespect. And from what most of the youngsters would tell me, when they said that their parents or parents, whatever they had, did take time with them, that they were giving them stuff that didn't make sense. And so you older brothers and sisters, when I say take time with the youngsters, don't be like nieces and sisters. Don't be educated fools from uneducated schools, because them youngsters gonna see through that. When you take time with them, you better give them the real. You better study yourself. You better come to these meetings. You better contact somebody and get the knowledge so you can pass it on properly. Like I just told you about the brief history of the Panthers here, that the transformation from the Slawson, from the Renegades, from the Rebel Rousers, from the bartenders, from the farmers. I don't hear nothing. No farmers. Airhole bartenders, rubber rousers. See, back then, these were the gangs that bunches and those had to deal with and struggling to change this gangster mentality into a revolutionary mentality. And a lot we can't talk about. Like I told y'all in them corners a lot of times that we have learned that in the 60s we ran our mouth a little bit too much about certain things. But you can rest assured, when we get in our little respective areas, that the word will be given to develop certain functions. So you can expect to see a change all throughout. Not because I'm out of prison. But because it's a new trend, it's a new effort that's being won all throughout the country that's liberating a lot of people, not only in prison, behind the walls, but in prisons on the other side of the wall. And the coming together is sincere because we now know who we can trust and we now know who we cannot. We now know a lot that we're going to use, we're going to implement, we're going to put to practice. And we can't do it without you. We understand ourselves as y'all. Y'all understand ourselves as us. We can't see each other as anything apart. I am, therefore we are. Therefore we are, I am. The Almighty principle. We cannot see ourselves as being apart. The contradiction that people see with people who's in Congress or people who's in different organizations has to be understood. It has to be understood, and it's easy to understand as long as you are around every master to put his two cents in. Because once he put his two cents in, you're going to end up calling a beautiful sister some bad names. You see, don't listen. You take everything with a grain of salt. All this gossip, all this rumor, that's one of our greatest enemies. And Hitler started that. He didn't start it. It goes back way back to Sun Tzu. But during Hitler's time and Mussolini, they would send troops in civilian clothes to their enemies before they ever sent troops in uniform. And they would be in them old zoot suits. Back then they wore them old big old suits. And they would go into the population. And they would mingle among the population. They would spread rumors among that population. And they would tell that population that Malcolm X wasn't no good. They would tell them that the Honorable Elijah Muhammad did dust and soap. And the next thing you know, they got us killing each other. It works. And among our people, I'm sorry to say, it works more frequently than not. We have to stop being so eager to hate each other. When we brought in the Black Power movement in the 60s, that was based on love. They said black was ugly, we said black was beautiful. They said this was African, they said this was yellow, we said that was African gold. We began to identify and that define our own reality. They said that was a fig tree. We said, no, that's a palm tree. They said, no, that's not a car. That's a horse and a buggy. We said, no, that's a car. We begin to define things ourselves. And that's what we got to do. When we said black was no longer ugly, it was now beautiful. You wouldn't believe the pride and the dignity that swept all throughout our nation. That scared them more than anything. They hunted Kwame Ture, Stokely Carmichael at the time. They hunted Brother Carson and Bedell and those because they knew that of all the guns, of all the breakfast programs, of all the rhetoric, that nothing hurt them more than black people loving each other. Black was beautiful. Black in the bed of the street of the Jew, all that. Now, I go on 10, I leave the street, black was still beautiful. I come back, black hated each other. That trips me out. We even allowed them to come and present that old European image. And a lot of people think that you own Michael Jackson, and I'm not talking against him, but I'm talking about that European features. If you don't look like the white woman, then you were ugly. If you don't look like the white man, then you were ugly. Those standards, we had gotten away from that in the 60s and made our black women the standards of beauty, our black men the standards of beauty, and we loved each other. Not people who look like Michael Jackson look, these European images look.